we shall start. So the thing is that we will be doing a typing tutor game. So if you don't know about the game, hopefully somebody will know. If you don't know about the game, it looks like this-ish. Actually, I can show you a screenshot of the old game. It's from 1987. Looks like this. Right? It's already a game on top of another software that basically teaches how to type on a QWERTY keyboard. And after every lesson, after they teach you, okay, your left hand should go from A, S, D, F, they also have a game after every lesson. So it's one of those games that pretty much, it's very nostalgic for me. Which is why I redeveloped the game in Python so that I can actually play it. Alright, let's try this. So this is the game we are trying to recreate. And basically, let me show you the gameplay. So the only link you need to know actually is the GitHub link. It's easier to go to the GitHub, it has all the other links required. And let's clone this GitHub. Let's do this. So once it's cloned, Python folder, best practice, always do a virtual environment. And I should have done the requirements.txt, but yeah, I'll do that later. So now that we have virtual environment activated, for Windows you need to activate with the bat. For Mac OS you should activate it with source. So how you know that it's activated? You know, by the BEND in front. In order to install, do a pip install PyGame. Now, the reason why we want to set to actually dictate the version number is because we are using a dev version. So the production version is actually on 1.9.6 at the moment. And we want to use the newest libraries and modules. So we use the PyGame 2.0.0.6. Once it's installed, check that. And this is the fun part. If you have Git cloned, you can just go ahead and run the app. So go to the source folder and let's try it and run it at python3-m-game. Takes a while for the first initialization of PyGame, and if it's all good, you'll see the game. And this is a game that we will try to reproduce during this workshop. Okay, you can type along with the words, and if you typed it correctly, you will get taken off the screen. Right? And if it hits the bottom, it will destroy the CP line at the bottom of the screen. So the goal here is that don't get you need to type all the words before it hit the bottom of the screen, and if it's all the CP line is gone, it's game over. So it's a very simple game. And then you have your game over screen, your start screen, and your playing screen. Right? So very simple. So ready to start?
Yeah.
Right? Okay. So that's the game. So let's create our folder where we will put all our code files in. Let's see. Let's find our empty folder anywhere. So far, following, you have the PyGame installed, PyGame 2.2.dev installed. So what's the version that you installed? 2.0.0.dev6? 2.0.0.dev6.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay. So once it's installed, let's just make a folder, right? Let's go. Let me just create a new folder here. And this will be our workshop. And we have all our codes in here. Alright. And let's basically one word every line and feed it into our game to be our list of words to display and drop down from the screen. And basically it's just we'll just prepare, you can just download it from my GitHub page, or you can just run NLTK and just in maybe 10 lines of codes you can get a list of words from one of the corpus libraries. So I won't be doing that here. So we'll skip all the way through to PyGame itself. So PyGame is a cross-platform library that basically it makes it easy for users, for game developers, to access the SDL module, the direct media layer that actually access your mouse, your keyboard, your sound system, or the hardware layer.
Oh, sorry. Could you speak a bit louder? I think stream people cannot hear that well.
Do they have any questions? Do you want me to repeat anything?
No. Yeah.
Okay.
They can hear you, it's just quite soft.
Alright.
Yeah.
So, yeah, remind me if I ever go again.
Sure.
Because the classroom is quite empty. Alright. So, we have gone through the installation steps. And straight away from PyGame, all we need to do is just import PyGame. So, there's a couple of changes since the previous versions that we want to make note of. So, let's create a new file and we shall save it as our game, save as game.py. Libraries that we will be utilizing. So if you don't do this, basically you can't access the PyGame libraries. So instead of doing like previous versions in 1.9.6, you do an import import star from PyGame locals or something like that, right? We will have to do the PyGame init and access all our locals from its PyGame itself. Essentializes our little empty object right here, and we want our screen. So we want the screen. So self.screen and PyGame display. Set the mode, and this here set mode, we need to pass in the dimensions of our screen, which is width and height. Make sure we do our width. And height. So we will go with 640 width. And 240 height. 480 height. That's a good number. So this gives us a very good little rectangular screen shape. We have screen, so now we need a display surface. So the display surface is basically the surface where you are drawing upon. That's why we call it a surface. So we have our main display surface, I'll call it DISP surf. And to do that, we need a display. So I'm going to wrap the steps I will do in a function. I call it init display function. And I'll wrap it up. So that I can actually show you that this, the steps required to init a display. What we need, what we usually do is set the caption. This is the caption on top. Like here, these are our window captions. So we do a pygame.display.setCaption typing tutor game. Then we create our surface. So to create surface, we need pygame.surface. We have a capital S. self.screen.getSize. Because we already have our screen that has already been set with width and height. So this surface is basically encompass the entire screen. And another step we need to do is to display surface.convert. Basically gets the actual surface, that gets an object of the surface and convert it into a live display surface. So let's return this. This will go into our display surface right here, self.display surface, our objects member. Alright, so one more thing, let's add the size of display surface to make it easier. We'll use this later on. And that's it. Okay, so for any game, what we need is also the loop itself, the game loop itself. So next, let's do our game loop. So very easily, set the flag. So if the display surface is okay, everything is good, we can start playing. through a loop. This is what we do for an event loop. So let's do an execute and put our event loop here. While self.running, we check for our events. Right? We'll create our event function later, and we want to render as well. Draw something on the screen. Please always check, draw, check, draw. Now that we have two new functions, let's define our functions. Then check event. So for each event, so PyGame is very, very straightforward. So for event in pygame.event.get, that's it. You get all the events. If event type is quit, so what does this pygame.quit keyword is? That means when the screen, the PyGame screen itself, when you hit the red button, whether on MacBook is on the left and Windows is on the right, you hit the red button, that's it, it bombs out, right? So we check that if the user hit the red button, we want to stop. And we bomb out. Let's define our render function first. It does nothing for now. Okay. And that's it. Right here. Oh, forget to execute. So once we have a game.execute, it will run. Let's give it a try. So python3-m. This here is kind of blank because we haven't actually done anything to the display surface yet, right? So the only thing we did was set the caption of the Typing Tutor game. Alright, so and this is 640 by 480. And when you hit the X button, it will quit. That's all we've done so far. So next, let's put something on the screen. Okay, following. Okay, this is the normal gameplay for any game. You start, play, game over, right? Simple. So make sure we have that state. Let's set our state. Keep it as simple as possible. And game over. Make sure we initialize self.state. Play. Nobody said anything. Self.state should be start. Yeah. Okay. So the interesting thing here we are going to add, I guess the thing is that we want to, the reason why this code here does not have the running the playing state is because we want two loops. One loop is where you go from start play game over, start play game over. This is a main loop, and another loop is where we actually take care of the running the playing logic. So we want to keep the plain logic on its own. So we'll keep that aside. So right now we only care about the main loop, right? So here we have our running and check events. And this is where we want to make sure that inside our check events, that we go from one state to another. So when it's quit, game state here would be game over. Right? And before we, and we want to return after this. But another, but we want to check for other events. If, so the very simple way to go from one screen to another obviously is key press, right? Press the key. We want to check that we have pressed the key. So for most games, it depends on the type of game that you actually create. For most games, you want to check the key up and not the key down or the key press. Because the key down and key press, basically you have key down, and if you long press the key, then you have plenty of key press events and then only a key up. So you usually want to know when the user lift the finger off the key instead of when they press down. So it depends on the game type. There are certain games that allow for user to long press and then you basically shoot multiple bullets, right? Then okay, you use the key press. But for ours, we want to make sure every hit the key is registered. So we look at the key up event. So we only care about key up event and if the event key. So for all these event types, right, there are different properties that are returned based on the event type. For a key up event key, there is a event.key. So we check the event.key. We want to only move on to the next state if the user press spacebar. Okay, you can check out what the different keys numerical representation is, the constant for each key is. For spacebar is k space, is pygame.k space. So if pygame, if the state is game over, we want to reset the state. Otherwise, increment. Looks about right.
You probably want to remove the second because of 42.
Which one?
It's assignment, line 42.
Oh, yes. Thank you. Self.state to start. Right. Let's hope this is good. We won't see anything, right? Because we haven't done anything yet. Right. Let's at least go on to the next step where we actually do something with our display surface. We have our render. So right now render is pass. Let's do here. So this is render self.display surface. Let's fill it with black. So when you do that, all you need to do is fill black. And yes, you do need to define your black. This is in RGB. So RGB for black would be 0. So this here, remember we have a screen and then we have a display surface. So when we do, what we're doing now is we are not actually filling the screen, we're only filling the display surface. For us to actually put it up onto the screen, we need to plate it onto the screen. So there's this thing, this function called self.screen.plate. Plate stands for block image transfer, so it actually transfers whatever that you have created onto the screen. So we want to bleed it onto the, we want to bleed the display surface onto the screen. So the first parameter is the display surface that we want to bleed, and second is the coordinates we want to bleed it on, which is from the start. We want to bleed the whole surface, and to update, we need to call PyGame display flip. So there's two different functions we can use. One is flip, the other is update. So this here, flip and updates, this is the difference, right? Flip will update the whole screen. Once you do a flip, it flips the whole screen. Update, you're only updating a certain portion of the screen. You can define basically whichever surface that you have drawn, the display surface, what you have drawn, you only update that portion. Feel free to ask questions if you have any. Right. So right now, again, we can't see anything also, but let's hope that we can get a black screen. It is a black screen, but it's not the black screen that I'm hoping to see.
It's trying to configure the font, I think. Let me scroll back up. Yeah, free type 2.
So,
I was in
the
try it. got the black screen. Hope everybody
gets the color. Yeah, we can hide the
double rocket. Okay. Get rid of that. Sorry. Okay, let me flip screen again. Yeah. It's complaining about that. Thank you. shouldn't have any. Get the screen?
Yeah.
You got it?
I have the black screen, but it disappears because I haven't finished the. So it just stopped running.
Okay. So we have 1%. Let's go. That is black. Next, we draw the font. So we want to use a font that is actually same width, because when we are typing, right, when you're typing is different from when you're reading. When typing, you want to know you have exact number of characters. So we want to find a font that has the fixed width font. So we are using the consolesport.ttf, and you can get this from my GitHub repo, or you can download it from plenty of places. Just Google consolesport. This one, let me make this smaller. Yes. So it's inside the REST folder, and it's right there. Just download this, put it in the same folder, and then you have that. Let me close this. So once you have the consoler's board font, we want it to be quite big, so somewhere around 36-point font is good. So we'll call this a big font. Right, self.bigfont, pygame.font, font blah blah blah, consoler's board ttf, 36. Now that we have our big font, let's use it. So this here, you can put it in here, but I'll put it in a text here instead because I don't really want to care about the actual drawing of it. So we'll put it in a function. Let's call this function called drawText. And we want to create the text surface where we put the font itself. Put it there, prepare it, we call it a text surface. We'll use the big font and render it with the text. This text, today we'll be using Typing Tutor Game. We want to use green color. So if we use the 255 green color, it's fair enough, it's neon green. So fair enough. So let's do green is 0255 and 0. Once we have the green, we need where we want to place our text. So this here we want to control via the text rectangular surface center. So we want the text rectangular surface center to be the center of the screen. So we have width divided by 2 and height divided by 2. That's our center. Pass it into the parameter. Set our text rectangular center. So we have our surface. We want to get the rectangle of the surface. So once we use the render, this render gives us a rectangle with the surface. And we want to grab it. So we get the text of the rectangle, set the center to be center, and then we print it. We do a block image transfer. Put our text surface with our text rectangle positions onto our display surface. So that's what this do. Once that's done, print it. We get this.
about my involvement because I only want to show something. She's more than.
Oh, you still didn't get the.
Yeah, because it's enough because. But I'm able to open.
Did you install the PyGame on the virtual environment or not?
I don't think so. Let me install this.
Oh,
I
installed
it.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Did your friend?
I don't think so.
Yeah.
here is quite standard.
Standard.
Can
put that in Windows as well.
I'm on Linux.
Oh yeah, so you can like
get
on Linux Mac, PTF or whatever.
Oh,
it's
not Python
3. We're doing different states, there's more than these two states. I know this is the main loop. We will eventually only see the start and the game over state. But let's just put down a second message. So let's say text 2 or message. Thank you. will start with our inner loop. So different people have different ways of coding. For me, I like to go from top to bottom. So I create what I'm expecting first. Replay, something like that. And then work my way downwards. So I know I'm expecting something like that. So let's get rid of it. Inner loop. We have outer loop. This is where we actually do the playing. We want all our playing stuff to go inside here. So again, import. PyGame. Class. Okay, play. Init. And we need the PyGame init again because in this this class, we still require the libraries. We still need help from the libraries to do the playing surfaces and stuff like that. Display surfaces where we play and stuff like that. So we still need PyGame init library to be initialized here. Okay, so once that's done, you pretty much you can actually copy the rest. We don't need the init display. And this one, we still need the screen, so we want to pass the screen in. Self right here, self.screen. We want to pass the screen in and let's expect the screen for our init. So self.screen, pass in from the top, like so. So whether or not you do that before or after PyGame init is not that important. So yeah, that one is not that important. But notice that we have a few things here that is follow up the same from your base game. So the first few lines are the same. Let's say this is the same. This is the same. And even this one. So that's be those three. So this one we don't need to. So we don't need to set the caption again. So all we need is actually the PyGame surface from the screen and convert it. Going on during our gameplay. It's not just check, render, it's actually check, do something about it, then only render. So we have three functions. So that, while it's playing, otherwise return, that's about it. So let's do our dev check events. This one we can copy from the game for now. events. We can copy. We actually copy all the way down, both the render, and then we get rid of the ones that we don't want. And even the draw text. Let's get the draw text as well. So these are the same functions that we use, but instead of game over, we do self.playing equals to false and return. So this will return from this function and it might go into loop and render and then return. And yeah, that's enough. Key up, space, this one we don't need. And instead of space, game over. So remember, when we exit from the playing, it's going to be the game over. So that's what this does. When we hit the escape key, you want to get out of playing to the game over. But when the user hit the cross, the red cross, we want to quit all the way. So the way to do it from PyGame is to call the PyGame.quit. If you return, it goes only to the game over, right? Not the PyGame quit the whole thing. So these two are the difference. So instead of black, let's do blue. And our blue, let's define our blue. Red, green, blue. So it should be. Initialize it yet. We haven't started yet. So we want to initialize every time we actually start playing. So every time you go from game over to the start, right, we have a new object, new gameplay object. So that's when we actually want the new game. So from here, at, let's say at where we check the stage, right? So here, we don't actually want to render when we are playing. So if self.state equals to playing, we want the self.game to be a new game. Else, we render. And remember, we need to execute the game before it actually plays self.game.execute. Every time we play, it's optically, we actually create, instantiate a new object. is forgot, yes, I did forget. Okay, the only place we actually increment the state has to be inside here. So remember to increment the state. So inside the loop, the space bar doesn't work. Remember, we're only checking for escape key. And it doesn't work also. Let's quit. So I'm not checking the escape key yet. Self.playing. Escape. After game, but execute, let's check event, game SQL. terms for size. And then we define our subgroup. This is a bit hard to see. Let me make it smaller so you can see everything. Too small?
Yeah, what?
We are in the inner loop now, so you want to bomb out quickly. That's how we do it. PyGame for quick.
When you define the width and height again?
Screen. Self dot width height, we get it from the screen target size. So this is where we actually initialize, we create a function and we initialize the words itself. So we get our list of words. Word is equals to self. word in it. Well, actually, strings in Python are array of characters, yeah, but we still need to do this to tell that we are not dealing with a string but actually a list of characters. So we convert our string into a list of characters. List of string. And because this is ASCII string, let's do a shuffle.
Save the event.key into our key hit. What is event.key?
they return the property of event.text and we save it in our self.keyhit so that we can get it after our check event in our loop. We can check our keyhit. Check our key hit here. Let's do that. Check. Self. Check. Hit. And that's all we need for one. Let's define our key hit. Empty. Check key hit. Self. To do. Screen at that point. So it's a limited number of words that the users are actually seeing. Those are our game words, not the full list of words. So it's a subset of the full list. Game words. And then we will create our words.py. So a singular object, so new file, word.py. This one is very small, very short. We only want a single word. We don't want the whole word, so we want to be able to access that word at any point, and we'll keep all our XYs in it. So, we don't actually need to import much. I don't think we need to import. No import either. So all we need is class, word, def, init, sample. What we need is the word. So we know that this is a class word, so we want to be very careful that this is the word and what is the text. And our text is our word. Next, we will need length. Because it's a string, it has a length. Self.y. This is going to be interesting. I'll leave that blank first. And our X and Y. Y. So we want to pass in the X as well. And define our X at the start. And our Y is going to be fixed. Okay. So remember, the words are dropping from the screen. So the Y is always at the same starting point. So we can tell. So we don't actually need that to be dynamic. So let's define our start Y to be about 20 points from the top of the screen. The X will display, right? You display at different points on the screen, your X is different. But the words always start from the top. So the starting point of Y is always the same. It's never changing, so it's a constant. So we define it as 20. So we have our start y and define these three functions. Length. Okay? So this length, you know right, the magic function for length? So magic function for length is the Python magic function where it doesn't do any calculation. So the reason why they have this length function is so that there is no calculation involved. So they directly grab the length without any calculation. So you can return self.length. So the calculation is done elsewhere. So it makes things faster. So get x, return self.length. why from here later. I think. Or we can do it now, I guess. So one good one that we will be using, get coordinates. So it actually returns both x and y together. This will be good to use. When we actually draw it. Am I missing anything? X and Y, yes. X always Y. Right, so we have that. We already have that. Objects. So we have margin X, we have our font width. Random choice, redundant. Okay, now we want to calculate X. So yeah, this random function is very, very let's create a function called add word. This function is a helper function for us to get a word from the list. So we get it. So we have our game words, yeah. So there. So if we add word. So we want to get the word. It's random choice. Random choice from our list. I'm doing something very bad here. Inconsistencies. Oh well. Both works, I guess. Random choice. So once we work. Okay, so the thing is that random choice. When we our game, there is one minor important point about the game is that the first character of every single word cannot be duplicated, because then the game as well as us gets confused which word are we actually typing. So only the first character matters, because once you type the first character, you know what word you're trying to type and you need to follow through. So we need to make sure that first character is never duplicated. So how I do that is that I actually store the first character, I calculate and just grab the first character everywhere in the game words. So this is the first character list, means word first character of for word itself dot game words. So this gives us a list of first characters. So it's a full list of first characters of the current words on screen. And if word you want to check, so we do a while in first char. We get one that is not currently. It's not a big group because the number of words on the screen is quite limited. Oh, I'm missing an indentation there. Alright. Okay, so this here, it makes it a little bit better. This actually gives us the, because when you draw the word on the screen, we no longer draw using the center, we draw from the top left corner of the rectangle. So here we want to calculate the maximum X position we can position the word on. So what we do is we get the font width, we times the length of the word to get the length of the rectangle minus off from margin X from the end of X. So max x equals to screen width minus margin x minus font width times length of word. point of the screen that we want any word to write until. We minus off the font piece, the length of word times font width, that makes better either way. And that's the max X we can actually put this word that we have randomly chosen. So now that we have our random number, we now have our max x, let's randomly choose our x. X. X of word now is random int. Random, not random int, random or random. Random int. Initializing a word object using our word text and X position. And we append the object instead of appending just the text. Alright? Okay. Slowly, slowly. We're getting there. We're drawing soon. We're drawing soon. Once we draw. Not drawing yet. Do you want to draw first? Okay. You want to draw first or do the timeout first? Thank you. coordinates. And here, instead of center, it's top left. Color is, now we change this. Yeah, it's white, it's fine. And 60 point, all good. It's no longer drawn hex. Let's change this to draw word so that it differentiates it from our center and our top left drawing. Give this a try. Let's see how many bugs I created. Okay, so it's not displaying because I haven't actually AdWords. There's no AdWords yet. So that's where the FPS comes in. So now let's get a bit of the clock. Let's get the clock so that we can actually AdWords when we reach the time clock. So we do need quite a bit of this. So this here, it actually tells us when we last add. We need to keep track when we add the word. And we need to have a clock. We need to get the clock to tell us that, okay, it's past time, we can add a new word now. Right, so that's what it does. So let's do a self.last add. Self.last add initialize it to be zero. So you always add something at least once. Self.last add is zero. And we want to track the timeout. So if you want a more challenging game, you can change this. So this is 2 seconds. So every 2 seconds, you want to add a word. So we are setting up a timeout and a clock. We need a clock. So FPS is frames per second. So generally, most computer screens, the frames per second is 60 hertz. That means 60 frames per second. So we want our game to be fast-paced enough, but not so fast-paced that it goes by before the user actually notice the word, notice the screen. So we don't see things if it's too fast. So we set it to about 25, so that's about 25 frames per second, so about 4 frames per minute. You will see it refreshes 4 times. See, that makes no sense actually. Right. So we want to keep track of the clock. So we want the clock. So PyGame has a clock. What did I call it? Was it a clock? PS clock. PyGame has a time module and a clock module. And a clock object. PyGame time clock. Okay. So the rest we'll do later. So now that we have a clock, we can start adding. So this is where we want to add word. We have an add word, right? No, we don't. Let's create our add word function.
This was in object Q, I think.
This is?
We created add word.
Oh.
Yeah.
Why do I put it in our play? Wait, let me double check. Let me double check something. Is this play or objects? I think it's play. It's play. And we will call our app work. Okay, so both the objects and the play has an app work. So if you notice here, the app work also calls the game objects.app work. So both play and objects have covered. So there are two different functions that does different things. So the one in play, it actually takes care of when, the time, right? So we check whether or not we want to add. So there's two tabs. If it's empty, just add la. Don't wait for the 2 seconds. No, there's no word on screen, just add. So that's where we have this, if not game objects. Objects.game typing.getTicks minus self.lastname. PyGame.time.f. GetTicks, I think it's GetTime, GetTicks. Ticks. Minus last self.lastname.
Thank you.
itself FPS clock tick. Right there, right after render. So the loop is too fast. We need to slow it down. That's what we need. Obviously not the words list. So am I missing words.txt? So where is my words.txt? Words. I'm getting the default. Words.txt with again, if you give me my words. Oh, yeah, don't hang on me now. Sorry?
What was the error message?
That's because we're not deleting them, right? It just keeps.
Oh, yeah, it just
appears. And I hanged it.
Press space to play.
Oh, yeah. So that's here. The you want the one from game or from the
when you start drawing the play, yeah.
And check. so that we can confuse people. Where's my word? Word dot py, move, y delta. Okay, it's good, so I should have the y delta. And, okay, this one is for when we type, so let's do the moving first before we do the type. So now that we have a move, so negative 1 means it hasn't been typed. If it's 0 means I typed the first character. If it's 1 means I typed to the second character. So that's how I register how I type. And if I set this to be 0, negative 2, means that I want to remove this from the our game words. Okay? So that's how I don't need to store another flag, that's all. Right? So So if a type IDX is negative 2, means that it's been removed, don't bother about this word anymore. So this is called set remove. And I'm trying to find out where I actually set the set remove. Let me find my code. So this is set remove typed move my delta. It's definitely not move.py. And I don't think it's in. I think it's in objects on the UI. Where's my move? Add get word move. It's in objects of py. So basically we want to set the boundary y, and once the get y is more than that, we set the remove. We don't need to worry about that yet. Sorry guys. So forward into the y, if word dot get y is greater than boundary y, let's set the cell dot bound y equals to screen height minus 40. Sorry. Minus 40, I think it's minus 40. Bound y, screen height minus 40, that's correct. So once it's hit to the 40 pixels above the screen, we have to actually remove it. So how do we do that? We do a cleanup function. Cleanup. So this, by calling this function, I'm trying to remove all my words that are no longer valid. See if it disappears. Okay. So how are we?
Is there a typo in cleanup? Self.game words. Line 48.
Yes. Very good. Thank you very much. Scenarios here. One, you have started typing, so you need to check where at which position what is the next character you need to check for. Second, you haven't started typing, so you need to check whether it matches any of the first characters. Third, if there's an error, somebody typed until a third character and fourth character was typed wrongly, then you have to reset. Right? And fourth, you finish typing the character, then you have to add score. So there are four different scenarios here, and all of them are different. So I need to call So let's do our typing flag. Let's set the typing flag. Where's my find which word it is that we have started typing. example, game words, give word. Dot typed. I need X. Bigger than negative 1. So it's typing, we need to check whether it matches the next word. This one not not really necessary because the first character we haven't set it to true yet, so we don't really need to set it to false. Else, then only we set it to true. Set remove, and we want to add score. So this here is a function. So there's a reason why I make this a function instead of just add the score directly. So let's keep track of our score. Self.score equals to 0 first. And let's create a function called def add score that takes a integer. So after we have drawn the word, I also want to draw the score. So we have a draw score function. Drawing a black rectangle at the red black bar on top of the screen. Right, so we have the width, we start from the 0, 0 width height. That's our top, left, right, bottom coordinates. Top, left, right, bottom coordinates. And we color it black. So that's our status bar, black background. Then we create another text rectangle. We draw our word called text rectangle with yellow. With the width calculated, I'll just calculate about 150 pixels from the screen and about 2 margin on the top, pixel margin on the top, and also the level. Don't put the level for now. We don't have a level yet. So just the score. So that's good. Okay. So try typing that and let's see if this will move.
We have a call function.
Yes.
For those to the white and green where you join a type text and type text, right? Shouldn't we get coordinates in 9 to 59 seconds?
Yeah, very good catch. Thank you very much. It's called. I remember. Let me check. Get caught. You're right. Thank you. Get caught. So this one. So. Did that work? Drawing my red. I haven't drawn the score yet. Where should I put my draw score? On render. Render. Draw score.
What is my problem?
Oh,
shit. I don't think it's the display of my
Yeah.
We are from the
Oh no.
Not not yet. Almost there. At work. Let's go. Work has no object. Let's go. Post not work. Let's go. Self. Let's go. Self. Let's go. Almost there. And a few more bugs. Work not defined. Set remove. Play. Set removed. 119.
Wait, more. That's like support.
Let's keep doing it.
Word is not defined. That's how it works. So you have your city line. So for range, for I in range of the full 64, my city line, I want to append every a block. So I randomize the height between 1 to 20. So you know this 1 to 20 that is about there. So remember when we hit the margin of 40, we get rid of the word. So basically our height should be around there. Margin of 20 or 40? 40. Margin of 40. So there is a little bit of leeway. So then we want to delete the last block. Remember, we should have 63 blocks, so the last block don't actually exist. The last block is there for us to keep track of our height, basically. The height of our last block. So the last block don't actually exist, per se, so we want to delete it first. This is a flag. To show which block has been deleted, that's a flag. And then we create an iterator. So this is very generic. So if you look, if you Google Python, how to create a Python iterator, they'll tell you do this, and then you have an iterator. The object is an iterator because you know the object has multiple units of certain thing. This here, it has multiple units of a block, so it requires an iterator. So you code that first. And then obviously this object has other properties. That's why you need an iterator for this. For the city line only, not any other property. So that's what the iterator is for. Then you have a delete block. So you give me the start x and the string length. I know how many blocks to delete. So I calculated which index the blocks that I should be deleting. And this function takes care of that. So it set, remember our block have a delete block. So I set the flag to be true. So initially our blocks all has a flag of true. If it's deleted, I just set the block to be false and I don't draw that block. That's how it works. Now the drawing part is obviously in our, you want to guess which file? Yes, it's in the play.py. So the reason why that one was not doing that was because, let me copy the words. Draw from start x y of the height to the next. So you're drawing three lines each time. You know what I mean? So, dong, dong, dong. Sorry, two lines. You're drawing two lines each time. So you need three coordinates to draw two lines. So this links to this, links to this, two lines. Start X, start Y, start X and Y, start X and X and Y. Alright, so always start with the horizontal first, obviously, so we go, was it? No. Yeah, this is vertical, it doesn't matter, so as long as it's the same each time. If we start with vertical, then we end with horizontal, so it's the same, whichever it is, it's fine. Okay, so yeah. If you want, you can play this one. So this one is not in the sound is not actually in the codes in the GitHub because it can be irritating. People open and did not expect the sound. Then I was like, oh no, people know I'm playing game. So yeah, but the codes are fairly simple. There is a page I think is still valid. The last page from the previous version here is still valid. It's just one line of code. I've downloaded this from freewavesnippets.com or something like that. So find something that is absolutely super short, 0.00 milliseconds, that is better. Because most of the sound waves there are pretty long. So yeah. Yeah, and that's roughly that. Did I miss out explaining anything? That was how it's drawn. Oh yes, destroying of the blocks. It's very simple again. I think I already explained, but I never showed you the codes. So the level, I haven't told explained the levels yet. Destroying of the blocks is when we hit delta, when we hit delta Y, right? Then we remove the word, right? That's when we actually delete blocks. So we have that. We have that that function to delete block that it gives us the start word of the Y word, and when we remove if it's above bound Y, remove, set remove, and at the word set remove we also call. But not word set remove, but the thing is with the set remove is a clean mark. The destruction of the blocks. It's just that if the flag is false, we don't draw that block. So as long as we set the flag, that's all we need to do, right? So next is the leveling. This is the fun part. Right, we want to level up. So how do we level up? There's a lot of different ways you can level up. Excuse me. Where's my level up? Here. So we know how many we have. I keep track of how many I've typed, how many words I've typed. If you want, you can just keep track of score and say if it's above this score, I want to level up. It's the same thing. So there are so many different ways you can do that. Because you return the game object to the play, you can actually do as many, what do you call that? That calculation of keeping track of all these these small little details as you want. Whether how many type count is there, how many errors you have hit, what is your word speed, whatever, right? This is where you put it in. You keep track of it. And then if you return it, then your game over page, your front page, you can actually display it. You can call your game object because it's there and query what is my error count. Or if you just care about the score, just give the score, right? Right now, I don't even give the level. So as long as I type more than four words, I level up. Reset the type count, and then another four words, I level up again. And every time I level up, if my FPS is less than 30, every time I level up, I add another FPS. I increment my FPS. Or if really more than 70 already, so I increment my Y delta instead. If this guy is just super quick, I increment my timeout instead. Right? This one, I don't think, based on this one, I don't think I've reached that timeout yet.
Okay.
Right, so yeah, seriously, the word, you can't even read the word, and gone already. Alright, so if you want to check, basically, if you change this to 3, you can see the leveling up a lot quicker. So this is pretty slow. Right, then start to be faster. Right, start to go faster, and so on and so forth. Right. If you want to basically penalize the person for typing wrongly, you get minus score. After you. And yeah, 4:30. Okay? Is it too complicated for a workshop? It feels like there's a lot of things.
Yes. There are like 4 tiles. Each of them are dependent on one on each other. And it's like,
imagine having the 4 files in one file, it would be
okay, dead. Yeah, that's even worse. The thing is that this has no
images. It's simpler than Alien Invaders.
But Alien Invaders was like a few kilobytes somehow.
This is also a few kilobytes. You get what I mean? It's pretty simple. It has zero images. Alien Invaders even have this small sprite. Okay, like that. It's, as you say, it's a couple of kilobytes of sprite. Yeah, both are fairly. The gameplay is fairly simple, right? Very simple. You start, play, game over, that's it. And it's again, it's top. One is bottom to top, the other is top to bottom. This one only has destruction. That one has destruction on two levels. You have your alien ship destruction and your own tank destruction on the level. And then you have your shield. That one is actually more complicated. It has 4 different game objects. This one only got 2 different game objects. Just your words and your. The only difference is that we have a lot more keys in this one. There's a lot more typing in this one. Right? A lot more characters, keys. And that brings in a bit more diversity. So, yeah. I'm trying to think whether. I mean, any simpler game would be boring, really. I guess I can create a tic-tac-toe game. But it would be more simpler for a workshop.
Actually, what's the difference between PyGame and TK, PK, the PyGame? You haven't heard of it?
No, is it a PyGame?
Yeah, it's TKINTL.
PyGame is a graphics library.
But so it's GUI.
Yeah, it's for you to design and do your own UIs. Like Windows, Form Builder and stuff. So, PyGame has a lot of interesting things that it did. It has a loop concept, so you can do basically anything that you need interactivity with it. When I first encountered PyGame, it was in the context of designing experiments. So like you have like a psych experiment, right, where you need to see the person's reaction time or academic focus. You know, when you see a red ball appear in the corner, you press the enter button, something like that. Then you can do statistical.
I'm not sure where TKTL is, what they are good at.
Yeah.
So what PyGame is good at is actually interfacing with your joystick, with your mouse, keyboard, your hardware layer, right? And your screen,
the
your sound. Yeah. So that's where it comes in. It tries to optimize and find the sweet spot between Python coding and your C base of connecting to the hardware. Right? So I'm not sure, but I need to Google the TKT. Yeah, so have fun. But Unity is also fun if you try.
Yeah, that's the next level up. Really.
Or even creating a game just from Android Studio. There's plenty of tutorials out there that teach you how to create a game in Android Studio. Depends on the type of game also. Obviously, this type of game, I need a keyboard. There's no point of me doing it in Android Studio.
You do
it
on the mobile phone.
Right. And the same as... Well, not the same. Yeah, it's the things that it relies on your... Like your alien invaders relies on your left and right button. The hit button is not. Actually, most joystick has a hit button. The mouse click and you can hit. But it's the left and right. You can't move that. You can't control it to that degree with your left and right. So that's where people... It's, dealing with this is great as a very basic, the most basic game. It's easier to implement that even in the HTML. I got that code. I mean, it's free that outside. There's plenty of the HTML email in the game. So give it a try. Pretty fun. I find it's hard for me to implement that this game, Typing Tutor Game, on the HTML because there's a lag between the keyboard and the browser. So that one is a bit harder. So this one helps me in terms of graphic or dynamic graphic drawing rather than relying on a sprite. I can basically use a sprite for my city line. And it will be easier for me to create that in the HTML. So drawing on the HTML is a bit harder. I need to rely on Canvas.
So the refresh rate for Canvas is slightly different. Or if there's another layer.
Yeah, there's another layer I have to take care of. So if I put it even like in a tutorial, then you have to teach that. This one I did when you could teaching the, what do you call that, the scraping of the text file thing. So that one, if you just read, it's all there, it's in a Jupyter notebook format. You can straight away just check it, it's just NLTK, and you just grab. It's more fun to actually use one of these texts than to use the entire brown corpus. So entire brown corpus is 700,000 or something like that. This one is what? This one is only one book. So one book, this is pretty big really. I think go for the smaller one, like, Carol, Alice in the Wonderland, that's a good one.
Bible.
I think it's 70,000 only. So you can, when you type, it's a bit more fun if you understand where the words come from.
Yeah.
If you have real words like legislation, it's like, oh, that's from the brown corpus, you get the word legislation. A lot of legislation.
Brown corpus is used in
No, it's library, the whole brown is used library. And the most text they have is actually law text.
Yeah.
Whereas that's how it happens. Yeah.
Then you're
getting
so, notwithstanding.
Yeah, so you see, it's only 7,000. Right. So this is one book. Just go for. I definitely recommend the ABC Motherland. That one's the best one to type with. Alright. Let me know if you can't find good sound and you want these three sounds. I spent half an hour getting this sound.
It's quite nice.
Yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah, correct. Google for typewriter sound. Only the glitch sound is on its own. Yeah, that's the glitch sound. Okay, Google glitch sound. Get the sugar.
So this takes care of abstractions like importing fonts and stuff like that, correct?
Yep. The main thing is not included is your images. They have plenty of examples. Bouncing ball is the most basic PyGame example. And somebody wants me to wrap this up so that people can play in and compete.
Oh.
Multiplayer.
Competitive game.
Multiplayer.
No, you can't play this multiplayer, man.
You suck at
it. You type, you, and for every word you complete, it goes on the other person's screen.
Oh, wow.
That's just Tetris 99.
Yeah.
That is good.